Hi, welcome to the Heart Powered Ventures podcast, Running a Business from Your Heart. And I am here today with Sarah Chick, who is the, gosh, you just told me your title and I forgot it already. This is terrible. So wait, events and program manager? How'd I do?
Yeah, events and programming manager.
I'm feeling so good about myself. This is going to be a great interview. We got the hard part out of the way, which is me remembering what you told me 30 seconds ago. The events and program manager at Raleigh founded, and as you may guess, in Raleigh, North Carolina. And we are going to talk with Sarah about content creation. And I want to give a little bit of, first of all, just a little bit of background, the context for where we are in the Commonwealth Group, our membership group for Heart Power and Entrepreneurs. And this month we're exploring content creation. And last week we had a beautiful meeting just looking at the factors that keep us dimming our own lights and not really bringing our content out in the full force and passion of who we are and what it is we have to say. And this week we're going to be working about how to actually start bringing content out into the world now that we've liberated ourselves a bit from whatever it is that would keep us from being fully ourselves and fully stepping into our light and letting other people see our light and our passion and our products and our offerings. So Sarah is the perfect person for this. I want to just, and Sarah, I promise you'll get a chance to talk, but I want to talk about you, so it's okay right now. I want to talk about how I met Sarah, and she could talk more about her. And before that, I actually have to tell another story that I told Sarah about my now wife, who the first time that I met, I was an ambassador for our Waldorf class, for the seventh grade Waldorf class and incoming students and parents. And I, and Julie was one of the names on the spreadsheet, and I called her and something really remarkable happened, which is that those of you who know me know that I have a tendency to go deep pretty quickly. And I went deep and she met me deep, and I went deep again and she met me deep, and we kept going up and up and up. And I figured, well, at some point one of us is going to chicken out and say, okay, this is about as authentic as I want to get with a stranger on the telephone. And that never happened. And then we ended up getting married. There's a lot that happened in between that. But the point is that I'm always on the lookout for people that have my ear attuned, that just continue to go as deep as I go and others go. And Sarah's one of those people. It actually happened when she was coordinating some work that our Web Squared program is doing with Raleigh Founded. And she was just kind of handling the logistics of it. But every time I would drop a little line in her email, she'd meet me and drop me a deeper line. And I thought, oh my God, okay, I found one. So Sarah, and for having that kind of energy and that kind of fearlessness and that kind of willingness and capacity to go deep, that's terrific. So, okay, that's enough of me. So Sarah, welcome.
Yes, thanks for having me.
You bet. Thanks for going deep. And not being scared to go deeper. So Sarah, tell me what you do, with a little bit about Raleigh Founded, what you do with Raleigh Founded, and then we can talk about your role both with Raleigh Founded and before as a freelancer around content creation.
Yeah, so Raleigh Founded, in a nutshell, it's evolved into many things, and I think we keep growing and evolving, but Raleigh Founded is this amazing entrepreneurial hub, really, that's a co-working space. And it's more than just space, though. It's become a place for folks to create, to vibe together, to have that kind of entrepreneurial buzz. And while in our community, whether they join us as co-working members or they join us as suite members, they always leave with a little bit more than they came in with. And the idea is that people can grow with us and grow within us as well, whether it's space, resources, and things like that. And that's kind of where I come in. So I run the events and programming here, and some of those things include networking events, Shark Tank-like events, things like that, and also coordinating all of our resource providers, sponsors, partners, and making sure that all of our entrepreneurs are really plugged in with the resources that they need to be successful with our vast network. And most of that is typically included all in their membership. Any other outside fees may apply with the actual vendor themselves, but we're able to make those connections and really help people where on their own, they may not really know where to start or how to really be successful and what they might need. So me personally, I'm able to kind of curate those connections for people so that they can be successful with their businesses. And I also probably at the a month after COVID took a dive bomb, started our podcast as well, connecting entrepreneurs to the resources that we do have in our community with our Founded Connect podcast. So that's a little bit about what I do here. Keep people happy and keep them on a success train and not a stuck train. Yeah.
Terrific. And so tell me about the what about the content creation piece and how that fits into your job.
Okay. So in a nutshell, I love content creation. It's one of my favorite things. And I think because I'm such an authentic storyteller and I really have built a multitude of businesses off of storytelling, whether it was tangible goods, services, and really I just had a knack for storytelling in general. So I kind of began probably 4 years ago doing some freelance content creation work just as a means of using my creative energy to write and photograph and help people kind of dig into what they couldn't find themselves. So often there's this content that's right on the surface, but people assume that nobody wants to hear it or it's not relevant. And so I would work with people to help kind of dig those stories up and plan content on a calendar basis, essentially, to be consistent. So that was something I really liked to do while being a therapist. It was a great creative outlet for me. And so I did that for about 4 years freelancing. And then I started here and started doing it for us little by little.
So let's just give me a quick overview of what content, we all have an idea of what content creation means. What are we talking about?
So when I personally think of content creation, I think of a meaningful way in which you're going to connect with the people that you want to appeal to regarding a solution, a product, or a resource that you're able to provide, really. And I really think it's super easy to break it down in just a basic understanding, a digestible sense of the who, what, where, why, when, and how that story can really become content. Oftentimes, I think there's a little bit of shame or pride that gets in the way of us sharing our stories and being vulnerable. And oftentimes that authenticity and vulnerability is actually what people end up buying into more so than your product, service, or business. I know every entrepreneur is super unique, whether they have a tangible good or they have a service they're selling. But regardless, all of us really started in the entrepreneurial world with a story and with our own why. And I think that being able to sit with yourself and understand that why yourself, and then being able to find the parts you want to reveal to the world so they can buy into you, that's one of the biggest steps to creating your content, is understanding your why, what you want to solve, and who you want to appeal to.
So I want to make sure, because, you know, it's like I couldn't have drawn this up better on the chalkboard if I tried. Because so often I know, as a content creator and as someone that assists other entrepreneurs in their businesses and including creating content, that so often what people are focused on or obsessed with is how they're going to present themselves, you know, what people are going to see, what the images they're trying to project and what they're trying to say and what they do and don't want to, you know, convey to the world. But what you're highlighting is just who we are and what got us into business, and whatever that differentiator is really the greatest force we have, the greatest selling feature in whatever content we're bringing out.
Yeah. And I feel like we have to stop perfection in its tracks. We have to be present over perfect. We have to seek progress over perfection. And we get so caught in these moments of everything being so perfectly curated that we actually forget that so much of the beauty and what makes people want to be a part of what we have to offer is sharing the mess, is sharing the struggle and saying, hey, I've been there too, and I get it. You know, some of the funniest things that I like to watch are look at bloopers, for example. How many people love watching bloopers? Bloopers weren't planned. Bloopers are imperfection. And I think of some of the accounts that I love following, or when I get to see the nitty gritty, the behind the scenes, the mess in the kitchen, the things that look imperfect, that are able to say, I'm just like you, I'm human, and I'm not perfect all the time. And I think that's one of the most important things, because everybody wants to find someone they can relate to. Nobody wants to feel like what they're creating is unattainable. And I think that's why content can be so scary. We watch these perfectionists share all these things and not go no deeper than a kiddie pool. And we think, well, I can't do that. Like that's perfect. But that's not our story. We have to share our story. And I think that when you weave in imperfection and authenticity, that's really where the beauty is had with creating content.
Now there's a, I think I told on a previous podcast, but when I was raising money for a business and I went to some, whatever it was, some event, and there were some venture folks from Silicon Valley, and they were talking about the difference. Someone asked them what the main difference was in raising money in Silicon Valley and raising money in the Triangle here in North Carolina. And the presenter said, well, over in Silicon Valley, we brag about our failures. Here in Raleigh, you try to bury them. And I think that's just that, you know, that's a more evolved ecosystem. They've been at this longer. And the more they evolve, the more they realize, hey, these failures are badges of honor. They're just who we are and what we do. So that's beautiful. And I can just say, Sarah, just in the relationship, what I think I picked up the first time with you was just that authenticity of, hey, we were just talking about everything. It didn't matter what it was. Did we? And just that willingness to show who we are and the confidence that we have that, and I'll get back to the content creation in a second, but it's such a critical point that the people who were turning, who would be turned off by our authenticity are not the people we want to be relating to.
Exactly. And when you try to essentially be something you're not, or only share the perfect moments and things that are going great in your business or with your product or whatever, that's not sustainable. Mm-hmm. So then when it's not sustainable and you go to continue to try to create perfect content, you're going to get burned out. You're going to hit a wall. You're not going to be able to sustain that. And then you're going to wonder why your business is failing. And the reality is that if you don't show up as you are, you can't sustain that.
That's beautiful. Okay. How do we create authentic content? How do you help others create authentic content?
Yeah. So I like to really start with, what is your goal? What are you trying to achieve? And I think that's one of the biggest things you have to stop and look at, is that we kind of just start creating content oftentimes feeling ill-equipped. So we just kind of throw the dart at the dartboard blinded, like, let's see what we can hit. And I think often if you kind of work backwards and think about, you know, what's my goal? What am I trying to achieve? So are you looking for recognition in your community? Are you looking to do sales? Do you have a product you want to sell? Is it a service you want to sell? And think about all the things that you need to achieve to be successful for you and what's going to help you with your business. And share what problem it is you're solving or what you are providing. Sharing over selling to me is so important when creating content. I don't want to be sold, and I don't want to feel sold to, or, you know, like kind of that skeezy feeling. Yeah. I want people to share me what solution they're going to provide me or what great must have they're going to, you know, bring into my life that I'm going to keep going back to for more. So I think that's one of the first things, is just sitting down and mapping out a goal. Because when you try to spread that net and cast it so wide that you're trying to reach everybody and sell to everyone, you've got to really look at who you're speaking to. Who does your product or service speak to? If I am, let's say I'm a clay jewelry maker in Raleigh, North Carolina, my target demographic is probably not going to be 60 to 80 year old women or 18 to 35 year old men. So I'm not going to worry about marketing to them. They're not my people. So you want to really get an honest view of what that looks like, what your goal is, and who those people are. And I think so often early in business, we get so stuck on having to be successful and make money and get going that we try to cast that net too wide, and we just have to scale it back a little and start there.
Okay. So just to be sure, because it's interesting how much this tracks an interview I did with Tom DeLonzo Baker a few weeks ago, when you want to share your solution with a specific market segment, would that be a way to describe what you just laid out there?
You got it.
Okay. And his was, you're writing your subject line of your email.
Yeah.
You think, and so solution to a segment. All right. Very good. All right. Let's go from there.
Yeah. So looking into, I think too, even especially the biggest marketing tool that's free, super usable, is social media right now. So everybody's on social media and everybody's doing it. So when you think even about just simple things to draw in people, look at your bio. There's biohacking, and it's not a health thing anymore. It's for social media now. But so many people look to simply offer brief things in their bio that help create that content. So let's say I was a hypnotherapist. So I would say I help, and I would take said target audience. Let's say it's women in menopause. I help 60 something women a year in menopause achieve X goals with hypnotherapy. So you're mapping out that right in your bio. So when you know your why, know your who, you're able to start with where, which is kind of the next piece of where you're going to look at to market yourself and place your content, essentially. People often think they have to be professional photographers, get super fancy with ad payments and placing all these strategic things. And to start off, you really don't have to. I mean, I just last year with the venue that I do content for now, I did nothing except Instagram, which is totally free. And it had over 77,722 views in 1 month just by organically telling stories and then converting those into sales of a little over 26,000. So it's using free things doesn't equate to not making money. Some of the best tools are free, and that's important for people to know.
So the what then, the what translates into that? So the why is like your goal, your solution.
Yep.
The who is who your segment is. What is the what? We're on the what's now, is that right?
We're on the where you're gonna go.
On the where, yeah. Okay. And so yeah. The where corresponds to where you find them, or the mechanisms you use, or what?
The mechanisms that you would use to really place your content on. So Instagram is super big, and when you have a business account, which is free, you can really track actually all of your analytics for free by location, who's viewing you, the age bracket, where they're coming from. And that's a great place to start if you're really not sure who is paying attention to you. Facebook is awesome for older crowds. It's still very much hip. I won't say it's as hip as Instagram is right now, but utilizing even some of the basic things that Facebook already has to place your content. There's some great local groups that support entrepreneurs. I know there's, for example, the Networking Women of the Triangle, which is a great place that you can share your small business on Saturdays and Sundays. So looking for free resources to really start placing your content and sharing your story and your why early on, before you start investing money in stuff that may or may not work, try to get a feel first.
Very good.
LinkedIn is awesome for sharing business opportunities and just collaborating really and connecting with people with your content, not so much as a sales platform, but Twitter is great. It's kind of hit or miss. I always tell people to wait to head to Twitter until they get a little bit more established. And then blogging is great if you have an older audience that you're appealing to, or a more mature audience. Not a lot of Gen Z millennials are taking a lot of time to read blogs, but a lot of older folks do. So blog content's awesome as well to share your story.
Okay. Let's move on to the next W.
The next W. All right. So we have what? So what is my content is one of the most common questions people would ask me. And sometimes you have to dig into your why to find your what. If you don't, especially if you're a service-based person, like a life coach or something like that, or you're doing business coaching, digging into your why and why you started often leads into your what. If you have a tangible product, like let's say you have a food truck and you sell vegan food, it's really easy to come up with some of that content, but you really want to use video and organic photos as much as you can. Using other people's stuff, not the best idea. Stock photos, if you have to, you have to. But I encourage people to get a white poster board or a white foam board and just start practicing with some of their products, business cards, like creating flat lays is what they call them in the biz, but creating some content that way to start photographing materials. Also taking organic pictures of storefronts, recipes, behind the scenes things. You want to make sure that it's directly related to you. Some of the best things that you can do when rotating all those what's is using pictures of yourself, which a lot of times scare people, but it's okay to collaborate with someone locally, maybe barter, like, hey, I'll give you, you know, 5 pies if you'll take a couple headshots of me. Mm-hmm. You know, get some pictures of your team, some pictures of your family, and feed into that why of what inspired you to do this. People want to hear that. and share that why. What keeps you going? What makes you seek out this dream? And who inspired you to start this? I know when I follow a new business on Instagram, and I'm super picky about people that I follow because authenticity is important to me. Those are some of the things I like to hear about. Pictures or videos of your finished product behind, like in the process. A lot of chefs, cooks, food trucks do some awesome videos showing start to finish recipe things, and showing behind the scenes. Like I was saying earlier, the bloopers, the failures, what went wrong, did a whole can of paint explode in your kitchen. And now you're like here and it's all over the dog, you know, here we go another day. And make things that you can dig deeper into. So if I start, let's say, with a picture of myself and, hey, I'm Sarah, I started this life coaching business, whatever. I'm then going to take that and pick it apart for 5 other posts of content throughout the month to start getting into the who, what, where, why, just of me. So you can really repurpose all your content when you cap a cornerstone like that.
And I've noticed too, that once, and I want to, at the, one of the things I want to make sure we hit perhaps to the end is just getting started, because it's so intimidating. I mean, I know, especially the older you get, the more out of, when you don't get with it. But I noticed that once you start posting and once you start looking at the what, you see what everywhere. Everything becomes a what. And so at the beginning, like you say, you might have to map this stuff out and try to figure
exactly.
out the thing. But after a while, you start to get a feel for it, and you see the eyes through, you start seeing life through the eyes of a social media content creator.
Well, and that's really like my, I mean, I love writing and I love doing copy, but I really love social media creating and those visual aesthetics. But even if you're an older person, if you're not super familiar with social media, you're just not really sure you're that versed in it. Some of the easiest things you can do to start out are just snapping photos and seeing what happens. Take your story and break it into small segments so you have your captions. Don't be afraid to be honest with people. People eat that up. Also, like literally going on the internet and printing out or buying a monthly calendar and saying, okay, I am going to post Monday, Wednesday, and Saturday because these are the best times.
Have we moved into the house, by the way? Is that part of the house? Or are we still in the what? So I'm trying to figure out where we are.
Yeah, let's dip into the house. We're in the house now. So we can,
So we'll talk. I don't want to break it up. I just wanted to see the transition so that I could be sure that I could take these 5 and present them to the Commonwealth. And I won't be making this up as I go along.
Yeah, no worries. So I think with the what, you can kind of tie right into the how. I think doing some of those things, snapping photos, planning a calendar. The thing is, you don't want to, people get so hungry for success right out of the gate that they start like posting every 5 minutes or every single day. And they just don't really maybe are super comfortable on social media or don't, they just want to be successful. But being consistent is much more important. So if you're just starting out and you're not super familiar, get comfortable just using your phone as your camera. You don't have to have anything fancy. I mean, most of these phones have pretty fancy cameras anyway. Thinking about what fed into your why and how you can capture that in image format. So if you start, let's go back to a food truck. If you started a food truck based on a recipe that you loved from your grandmother, take that old recipe that you probably have handwritten somewhere, lay it on, you know, a whiteboard, put a flower next to it and capture a photo. It's just making things look aesthetically pleasing. And then commit to what you're willing to do. If you can do it 3 days a week, continue to do it 3 days a week and show up consistently. Now, I don't want to scare people too much, but one of the best ways to attract people is to go live on social media. You really attract in a big audience there, and that's super scary. But I love it. It doesn't bother me, but it can be really scary when you're just starting out. So think of what you can do with what you have and just start eating the elephant one bite at a time. It may not be perfect, and you'll watch your page evolve. You'll watch the aesthetic evolve as you get more comfortable in your own branding.
Okay. So this is great, really great. And not just as a great information, but it's all within the context of authenticity, because everything you're talking about is really how to just how to convey the inner to the outer. You know, it's like capturing you, the essence of you, which is in your offering, which now you want to be able to put out to the world through various content so that they can get a flavor, a feel for who you are and what it is you've created. So what I've noticed, certainly in some of my own early reticence, and definitely in the entrepreneurs that I work with, whether it's in the Commonwealth Group or through mentoring, it's just hard to get them off the dime. You know, it's really hard to get them started and keep them started. I guess one thing I see all the time is people just not starting, but not following through, just almost the day-to-day grind, if it seems like a grind of content creation. And then the other one is just getting started. So, you know, help us overcome the inertia or the fear of success or the unknown. Just tell us what we need to know to really get us moving.
I think one of the things that you guys could probably do together, if you felt safe, seeing each other in COVID and all that stuff, I think doing content creation workshops are amazing. Mm-hmm. Everybody shows up at a space. You want to use this space? I'm happy to donate it to you. You know, everybody shows up, cameras, phones, whatever, brings a couple products or things that they have to sell or whatever entice them, and everybody collaborates together. So you might sit down and I usually start people talk about your fears. What's got you hesitant? Why don't you want to share this? What's the worst that could happen? What are people going to say? You're a fraud. People don't know you. They can't say that. So you start off and hammer out those fears. And then in that collaboration, maybe I take headshots of you. You take headshots of this person. We're just going to get some basic things going to feel comfortable. Get some pictures of your product, work together, bounce ideas off each other. If you're a pie maker and I'm going to buy a pie, this is what I want to see. You know, getting some feedback from each other to see what's really going to work from an outside perspective while keeping it with people you're comfortable with already. I think that's a great place to start and map out what you feel like you can actually commit to. It's easy to start small, maybe 2 days a week or so posting content, versus starting committing to 5 days a week and then realizing that's not achievable right now. So I think starting small and collaborating is super important.
It's terrific. And it just plays off. It's funny. I was just working on we had a marketing retreat this weekend for Hard Powered Ventures for the company. Mm-hmm. I was doing some of my to-dos and it was like features and benefits of, you know, what it is we're doing. And I kept coming back to the collective aspect of it, just how much, how hard it is on your own. If you're an entrepreneur, it's hard. If you're a heart-powered entrepreneur, if you're trying to, you know, work with integrity and heart and bring yourself out, it's even harder. And when you have others, whatever that looks like, as trite as it sounds, it just makes such a difference. And I can see what a beautiful way to just kind of collaborate and bring that out into the world. So Sarah, this has been lovely. I knew you were good. I didn't know you were great at this. I knew there were other things you're great at. So this is fantastic. If people want to get a hold of you and just pick your brain or whatever else might be of value to them, they're getting going, what's the best way to reach you?
Yeah. So you guys can contact me reach me by email. Sarah@RaleighFounded.com is really a great way to reach me. You can find me on LinkedIn also at Sarah Chick, C-H-I-C-K, just like the bird. So
it's a real name too. It's not her stage name.
It is not. That's real. And I'm happy to talk about anything from content to how to write captions to how to collaborate and involve other businesses. I think all that is super important. We often sell ourselves so short and we have such a powerful story to tell. And truth be told, we've probably been giving away stuff for free for years that we can, you know, ask for people to help us with that and show some favor and share our stuff. So there's so much that weaves into it to be successful.
Terrific. Sarah, thanks. Thanks a million. It's just great to see you. And I'm really glad that you met me and raised me one, because it really enabled us to me to see you and bring what I see out into the world. So thanks for that.
Yeah, for sure. And if it's helpful, I can kind of take some of the notes that I used here for this conversation and give them to you guys to use in the collective.
That's beautiful. Thanks a lot.
Yeah.